So I think this looks absolutely awesome. And I've seen people do similar things before, blueprints on work tables covered in plexiglass. These are actual blueprints for some components on the Adcock Shipley horizontal mill. So that's nice. They were falling apart, so I figured this was a good place for them. Right, kind of fitting. Looks awesome. Are you just playing now?
Yeah.
I think we're mixed.
Okay.
Yeah, I've seen it. Get it all the way to the bottom here. Good job. Like that?
This winter.
Okay. So this 5-gallon bucket is actually the coolant reservoir on this lathe, believe it or not. Originally, the coolant reservoir was under the end foot, or it was in the end foot of this lathe. There was a pump down there, all the rest of the hardware that had to do with the coolant system. But over the last 70 years, somebody had removed it, and they had hammered, or they had knocked a hole in the chip pan of this lathe and just hammered it lightly in a way to where all the fluid just runs to a hole in the basically the center of the pan. So I set this 5-gallon bucket all under right. That hole.
New coolant
with a hole in the lid of the bucket and the coolant just runs back into that. So it works, and then I have a small pump that pulls it from the bucket and runs it up to the spout here. So the coolant that I drained out of this lathe, which I didn't show, just dirty coolant, had been in this lathe probably up to a year before I even started the reconstruction on this building, so it was way overdue for a change, and I hadn't been using it. I'd just been using coolant in a spray bottle to get me by, but that's just not near as good as flood coolant, so I'm glad to get this stuff changed out. So I picked up a new 5-gallon jug of soluble oil. I was using Super 100. Just the white, standard white soluble oil that I've got in every one of my machines right now except for the lathe, but I used the last of it in the do-all bandsaw, so I had to pick up a new jug. Now this is, it's labeled sawing coolant, but really it's for anything, grinding, lathe work, mill work, just general metal work, safe for copper and brass, just general use metalworking fluid or metalworking coolant. So this is what's in the lathe right now. I mixed it 10 to 1. We'll see how well it works. It's kind of a blue color where the other stuff is just white. So this stuff may actually work better in the bandsaw because I believe you can see through this stuff. It's a little more transparent than the white stuff that I've been using, and that will help if you're trying to cut to a line. So we'll see. Maybe in the future we'll put this in the bandsaw, but for now it's got the Super 100 in it. But it's good to change out your coolant often. This stuff gets nasty pretty quick. So the other day when Keith Rucker was here from the YouTube channel VintageMachinery.org, he was nice enough to bring me a really awesome gift. So let me show you what he brought. I've never heard of this brand, NSK. They're Japanese made. And that is a from 6 to 12 inch set of mics. Really nice mics as well. Like I said, never heard of them, but they're just forged steel. Carbide faced. I mean, they feel as good as any mic that I've seen, and they also read in the tenths, which is an awesome thing. So I really appreciate that. Keith's an awesome guy. They've got a little bit of surface rust starting here and there, but these are overall in great condition. Even the paint on them looks good. Got the standards for them as well, which is nice. So check out that big mic. NSK. So there's nothing wrong with these mics at all. Really feel like great quality. And as much as I use calipers or mics of this size, they'll be just fine. Right? The chances of me wearing them out and needing the carbide faced anvils on a 11 to 12 inch mic are basically zero. I know some people do larger work and they use these daily, but for the stuff that I do, it's not all that common. So I'm just going to pull these out, oil the anvils and the screws, just wipe everything down, and then put them back in the box. That way they're nice and clean and won't degrade. So these things are pretty dirty after sitting in a box for who knows how long. A few weeks ago, I picked up this Sterrett tool and instrument oil. I wanted something I could oil my gauge blocks, mics, just grinding vices, whatever, precision equipment with, that would not turn to some brown goo like a lot of oils do in 6 months and just make your tools all sticky. So apparently this is what Sterrett uses on their own tools when they're new. This is the special high refining makes Sterrett oil colorless, and it is very clear. So hopefully this stuff will stay clear and not turn to goo in 6 months. It says it's great for cleaning, all-purpose, cleans, lubricates, polishes, prevents rust. They even say somewhere where the people use it on wood. Maybe so. So when I'm adjusting mics, I like them to have a little bit of resistance when I turn the graduated dial or the anvil. These right now, they're actually too loose. I like them to have a little bit more drag than that. So these have a split nut in the back, many will. You just take the wrench and tighten them up a bit if you want to increase the drag. A little at a time until you get the feel that you want. That's really close. I just wanted to pinch that thread a little bit harder. That way you have to deliberately try to move the anvil. A little more. The slightest bit of resistance, but not much, but it's not turning super free. And that one's right on the money. So happy with the calibration on all of these. They're all extremely close. Got them all taken apart, cleaned up, and oiled. All the standards clean. And they're ready to use. I trust them to use on anything. That was a nice gift from Keith. So not too long ago, a viewer brought me a bunch of these old tool blanks. Some that are missing the hardware, some that have been ground on, some that have been crashed, and then some that are really in really good shape that I'm using. But I kept them all because the material out of these is awesome. It's some really tough stuff. Now, around 40 to 42 Rockwell C according to my tester, and they're relatively tough to machine, but they hold up well. If you need to make some parallels or something, these are awesome. In fact, I'm going to make some out of the leftover stock out of this project here. Now, what I'm doing with this piece here, which is half inch by half inch by 4 inch, is I'm turning it into a couple blade guides for the do-all bandsaw because I need some guides for some 5/8 inch wide blade. I've got blade guides for half inch. I've got them for 3/4, but I don't have them for 5/8. So, and 5/8 blade guides, I believe, are only half inch by half inch. They're not actually 5/8, just like this blade guide for half inch wide blades, only 3/8 of an inch wide. So we're going to make some blade guides. I'll show you a couple of them. I got to make 4, but you get the idea. That's what this is going to be. Blade guides for 5/8 blades for the do-all bandsaw. So last week on Instagram and Facebook, I posted a question regarding these two outlets on the front of this saw, asking if anybody knew where I could get this plug at, because it's not your standard two-prong 120-volt outlet that we're all familiar with here in the States. This is much smaller, both in width and the little prongs are narrower. So I was questioned, where can a person find a plug like that? And I got all kinds of responses. Some said go to Lowe's, which I seriously doubt you're going to find that at Lowe's. But a lot of people gave me a lot of links to vintage electronic sites where stuff like that was available. Remakes, people who restore old electronic devices and stuff. You can still get this stuff. Although if you're not in the world of vintage electronics, you don't know where to look, which was my case. What I ended up doing, at least for now, is just adapting a standard two-prong plug, filed down the prongs a bit to where it would fit inside of here. It works just fine, and for as much as this thing's going to get plugged and unplugged, it may work forever. But I would like to eventually get the right outlet. So I want to say thank you to all the people who responded to my question on that. And yes, this has a step-down transformer, so 120-volt single-phase outlet, three-phase 220 inlet to the saw, and I think that's pretty neat. So it's just for a work light, right? No real heavy draw or anything. So it works. So because I showed this exact operation a couple weeks ago, I'm not really going to go into detail here, but we got our sine vise on the grinder set up at 45 degrees, and we're grinding the face of our blade guide to 45 degrees. It really needs to be close. That way, the part that actually rubs on the blade of the bandsaw contacts it nice and flat, gets a lot of surface area there, and gives it a long wear life. So that's all I'm doing, is dressing that saw cut that I just made on this blade guide on the bandsaw. So I've got these to shape. The only thing that I need to do now is put the slot in, the clearance slot for the bolt, and this is really the hardest part. So because I want this slot to be in the center of my part here, just using the edge finder here, the 200,000ths of an inch side of it, coming in, setting my dial to zero, and then doing a quick double check. Now on the new, on the do-all mill, once I get it finished, I have 100% there is 100% certainty that it will have a DRO on it. You can get those things for relatively cheap these days, a few hundred bucks, you know, $300 to $500, and that is such a worthwhile investment, in my opinion. At work, our milling machine has a DRO, and actually it's a two-axis CNC, but so nice. So I've established the length of the slot that I want on this part, and I've set the end stops on the table. That way I can travel from one stop to the next. I don't have to look at the dials or anything like that. Starting out with a carbide center cutting end mill here, plunging on each end of the cut, gives the chip somewhere to fall and leaves less room for it to chew up extra chips as you travel through the slot. Just like to do it that way if I'm not using some sort of a mist cooler or something to blow those chips out of the way. Now, you can cut these with high-speed steel, these tool holders, but not recommended. One slip up and where your end mill rubs a bit and they turn to glass and it chews up your end mill. So carbide pretty much only on these. You know, the good thing about using these old tool holders is they're already relatively hard in the world of steel. Good wear resistance, right? You don't have to go and have your part heat treated. A lot of us have some of these old tool holders laying around, so they're great for little odds and end parts around the shop. Parallels, parts like these that are going to be riding against a bandsaw blade. Probably a little softer than a bimetal bandsaw blade, but not, you know, so hard that you can't machine it. So if you're just doing bulk material removal and you don't need an end mill with a 90 degree point on it, like a real sharp edge, start buying them with a radius. They seem to last twice as long or more, in my opinion. This is, I believe it's a S545R made by Niagara. I've had great luck with these end mills. They just seem to keep cutting, even in this hard stuff. Just buy them with a radius if you don't need that sharp end. Hey Chloe, do you think that was a good use for those old tool holders? Huh? So I've got a couple chunks of leftover steel from the tool holders that I cut up to make the blade guides for the do-all bandsaw. And what I'm going to do with these is make some parallels out of them. They're really close right now, actually. I've ground them all the way around just because I wanted something to grind, actually. But we need to cut them both to the same length, and then we need to grind the bow out of one of them. One of them is bowed in this direction, like a rainbow. You can't see it, but if you put it on the surface plate, it rotates around the center. And when you put it on the mag chuck and mag it down, it pulls the bow out. You turn the mag off, put it back on the plate, it still has a bow in it. So we'll have to grind these in the vise to get that bow out. grind one side in the vise, flip it, put it on the plate, and then grind the other side to get the bow out of it. Hopefully that made sense. So let's cut this to length, cut a little chunk off this one, and then precision grind these to match, and then we'll add a nice thick set of parallels to the box. Even though these are a little thicker than what I do like, I'm not going to trim them down unless I need to. So here's a visual of what's going on. So we've got this sitting on the end, and we flip it over, and you can see it's rotating in the center, so that tells me it's bowed like a banana. That one's not as bad as this one, though. Let's see? Just the tool holders were just bent, right? They've been cranked down so many times with bolts and stuff that they just bend, and you cannot get that out on a surface grinder with a strong magnet, because what it does is it just pulls that bend out of it. You grind it, and if you checked it on the plate, it'd be perfectly flat, but then when you relax the magnet, you know, the steel goes back to where it was, relaxes, and it's bent again. So we have to get that out. This one, about 3/10 probably. This one, about 2/10. They're not horrible, but this is some really good steel. And we'll match grind them together and get that bend out. I'll show you how to do it. So I picked up a few new small hand tools for the shop. I want to share them with you. Up until recently, I was using this as my metric pitch gauge for checking the pitch on metric threaded bolts and stuff. This is one of those cheap ones that you get out of the low-cost tap sets, and they're just not well-defined. You know, they left me guessing a few times whether I was correct or not, especially on the finer metric pitched gauges. Just not a good gauge. So I picked up this Mitutoyo number 188-151. Now this is both SAE and metric. So we got a metric side here and then a SAE side, which is twice as many as the metric side. But you get the idea. Really nice combo thread pitch gauge. I like that. I like it a lot. Got it off Amazon. Same place I got the Sterrett set of Sterrett feeler gauges, because this is what I was using before. Although it worked, they're pretty rough shape. I've got another feeler gauge set, but it doesn't have quite as many feelers on it, but this is so nice. It is a Sterrett number 66B. I'm going to need some good feeler gauges here coming up for long, so I went ahead and bought a couple, which I don't regret at all. Also bought this set of Klein scissors for the shop. These are designed for electrician work, but you can use them for about anything. So these are nice. I've been using these for about 3 weeks, 4 weeks now, and really like them. Like them a lot. So if I do my part on this grinder, I expect these 4-inch parallels, roundabout 4-inch, to be within a tenth. And all it takes to get with it outside of that is just a small burr on the mag chuck, a piece of debris underneath the vise. It doesn't take much to get outside of that tenth. So I gotta make sure everything is clean. This vise does not need to be square in any way because we're only grinding flat. So I need to dress the wheel. And I'm just gonna hold the nib in the vise. I'm using a cluster diamond nib. I'll show it to you. So hopefully you can see that. That is a cluster diamond, which just means it has diamonds all around the perimeter here and one directly in the center. So I'll use this one, or I'll use this one, which is just a single point. I can't say that I'm advanced enough to be able to really tell the difference just dressing a wheel flat like this. You know, they both work, and I rotate them both quite often to keep from wearing one spot on the diamond more than the other, or on the nib more than the other. Go. Wheel dressed. So just in case it's not clear, the magnet itself pulls the bow out of the parallels, and then when I take them off the magnet, they go right back to bent. But putting them in the vise does not pull the bow out of them. I can grind one side, and then the next side I can just take the vise off of the mag chuck and put the parallels straight onto the mag chuck, because there'll be no bend in the part to affect it. And you know, that's how you grind the bow out of a part, or at least how I'd do it. And I have to say, this turned out really good. So there's the finished parallels. Actually, I made two sets, only showed one, a smaller set and a larger set. And I used two carbide insert holders, they're inch by inch by 4 inch, to make four blade guides, and then I got two sets of parallels extra from the excess stock. So we got these, ground those flat, and now they're rotating slightly off center, so they're much flatter than they were. Easily within a tenth of parallelism. Nice and true. On both sets, I did not grind this set yet to match as far as length, but you get the idea. I mean, pretty nice for what otherwise would have been scrap material. This small set, for some reason, picked up a lot of magnetism, either from the mag chuck or it was just pretty magnetic before I started, so I need to run those over the demagnetizer, but you get the idea. Awesome use of old, otherwise scrap material turned into useful tools for the shop. Works awesome. So I'm going to get back started on my cedar shingle siding. Now I'm getting pretty close to done, still a little ways to go, but because the weather's dry And that's when I said I would get back started on this months ago. I decided to at least try to get the majority of this knocked out. Let's finish it up. Well, try to, and talk about it a bit. So let's get a little closer look at the cedar shingles, or shakes, whatever you want to call them. Now, these are made by SBC. These are untreated, so there's no coating or anything on them, just a raw piece of kiln-dried white cedar. Got a wedge shape to it. I'm doing a 4-inch reveal, so there's only 4 inches of each shingle that's exposed. And the reason why I'm doing a 4-inch reveal instead of a 6 or a 7, which means you could get away a lot cheaper because there'd be less shingles on the wall, is simply because I think it looks better with a less reveal. You get more shingles on the wall, more protection, plus there's less unsupported shingle because you don't put nails in the part that is revealed. Less unsupported shingle out there to blow up or whatever. Now, cedar's good because bugs don't usually like it to eat it. You will get the occasional woodpecker that thinks your house or shop is a tree, but I haven't had any of those issues so far, so we'll see. I think the main thing is to keep all your wood products off the ground to where they don't have a good path for insects to get started. Go from really wide to really narrow. Just depends. So I said these are B grade, so a few knots and stuff, but that doesn't matter because there's only going to be 4 inches of each one exposed. Let's start putting some of these up on the wall. See if we can get this shop a little closer to finished. So let's get a fast look at the toolkit. The nailer I'm using is the Metabo NV65AH2. This thing is awesome. I bought it specifically for this siding job. Don't regret it at all. And I've used it for a few other jobs that I haven't shown, but this thing has not missed a beat since the day I got it. Don't regret that, not in the least. We're going to be using the little Rockwell skill saw. This thing's amazing for this, and it really makes trimming shingles to length, because every so often you got to trim one. Makes it easy. Got a big square. We've got a level over on the window seal, a small hammer, a chalk line, and a pencil. And really, that's about it. I also forgot to mention a string line, a level, and a straight edge. Also comes in handy. I like to set my shingles to a line. So I've marked up the window seals. You could call it a story pole. So I've already done all the math on this as far as where my lines are, where my shingles, my next row starts. So I just follow that, run a string line, or on short sections like this, you know, just mark the ends and run a straight edge across it in a pencil and call it good enough. So what I do is 2 nails per shingle, no matter the size of the shingle, even a really small one. Or if it's a really wide one, a little wider than this, I'll usually put 3 in them. But that's about it. And I also space my shingles at least 1/8 of an inch, because this row has been on here for a while. It's like 80-something% humidity out here, and they're almost closed up the gaps. So we don't want to put them too tight together, because then when they swell, you know, they'll bulge out and act all silly. So space them everywhere and you shouldn't have any problems. Nail above the reveal of the next row, or underneath the reveal of the next row, whatever you want to call it, should be good to go. Also want to make sure that you're covering the gaps of the row below it. You don't want to leave a path for water to travel down and get below the siding.
So down from underneath the
And when I come to the end here, just pull my tape measure as 5.5 inches, so anything slightly below that, 5 and maybe 5 1/4 would be perfect. And if I don't have it, I'd make it. So, starting to look pretty good. Got some unwanted residents living up here under the eave of the roof. Actually, up there is a paper wasp nest and a regular wasp nest. Let's see if we can not get stung and not fall off this ladder. See them over there? We got the antidote, though. Carb cleaner. Like rain, like wasp rain. Well, probably would help. Yeah, they don't like that. I hate to do that to him, but we're not friends. So I've decided that I'm going to try to finish up this siding. I want to get this done before the weather starts turning cold, because the last time that I worked on this siding, there was snow and ice on the ground. So before this summer's over, and it won't be long, we're getting some cool mornings late July. We'll be in winter again, and I still won't be done with this. So, I'm going to make a hard push this coming week just to finish this up, get this behind me, because I think it's really going to look good once it's done. Although, probably a good day or two of work left here, even though if this wasn't on a hillside, you could finish this. Two guys could finish this that knew what they were doing in a day, the whole thing. But its location makes it real difficult. It'll be worth it when it's done. So last week, me and Elizabeth did our first ever live stream on the channel, and it went really well. I apologize if you missed it, but it was just a test run, pretty informal, wasn't announced, and it went really well, other than the audio wasn't all that great. But Elizabeth nor I had a mic on the device that we were recording the live stream on, and it was kind of quiet. So throughout the week, I've worked out a system. I got us a Rode Go 2 system mic. That way we can both have a mic and we can hook it to our device, and hopefully it will improve the experience and you can hear us a little better. So if you're interested in joining me and Elizabeth in a live stream, potentially today, August 7th, 2021, today on the release of this video, join us around 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's what I'm guessing. That's what time I'm guessing that it's going to be whenever me and Elizabeth can tie down. Our schedules meet up to where we can sit down for 30 minutes or an hour and shoot the breeze with the viewers. We really enjoyed the last one. I feel like that I maybe could be able to get in a little closer touch with the viewers and maybe vice versa. So if you've got any questions you'd like to ask, feel free to drop in and say hello. We would love to have you. And big thanks to the guys who stopped by in the last one. It was kind of
spur of the moment thing, but it worked really well. So that's it this week. Hopefully this all works out and goes smoothly, but only a test will tell. So that's it. Thanks for watching. Thanks to anybody who threw a dollar in the hat and it helps amazing, because I wouldn't be able to get this mic for us to use to make the experience better. So that's it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time, or maybe later on today if you want to tune in.
The birds fly south as the light leaves your eyes. Hold on to your dream. Oh, I know you wanna scream. Since the day you're born, you're just a flower on your own, waiting for the sun to blossom, hoping to break through.